Good morning. My name is Rebecca Sharp. I'm the Executive Director of Special Ed and Student Services for Falls Church City Public Schools. And we would like to welcome you to one of our summer parent training series. And we are very, very excited and lucky this morning to have Berkeley Gerstmer and Katie Scipione, make sure I say that correctly.
Scipione, yeah.
Scipione here from the Fairfax County Community Services Board. And their presentation today is going to be about strengthening mental health and wellness during COVID-19. So we are very excited to have them provide this session for our parents here in Falls Church City. And I am going to turn it over to these wonderful ladies to share all their great information with you. Thank you for this today.
Great, thank you all so much for having us today. I'll just reiterate, we do work for the Fairfax Falls Church Community Services Board, and we work in wellness, health promotion, and prevention. And I, along with my colleague Berkeley, we fully understand that parents and caregivers are feeling a lot of stress during this uncertain time. We get it because we're parents too. So what we want to go over today is really about, you know, all the questions that we have in our minds. How are we going to cope? How are we going to stay connected? How are we going to help someone if someone's in distress? What do we do? Who do we go to? What questions do we ask? And what do we do? How can we help? So we hope that we can answer some of these questions and give you all some resources so that you feel equipped during this uncertain time. Okay, so we are going to start out by talking a little bit about stress. So there are different types of stress. Stress is actually extremely normal. It's a reaction to a physical or emotional challenging situation. And I'm going to start out with talking about positive stress. So positive stress is good. If you're starting out on a new job, it's your first day of your new job, you may feel stress. Or if you're presenting a report to your team or to your class, you may feel stress too. I always say that if you feel this stress, it means that you really care about it and you want to succeed. Then I'm going to talk about tolerable stress. So tolerable stress is a type of stress that activates your body's alert system. And your body is activated in a time-limited way. And it's buffered by the support of positive relationships that allow our body to cope with the stress. So if someone has had a severe injury or the loss of a loved one, they kind of lean on those positive relationships to make this stress more tolerable. And remember, it is time limited. It's not an ongoing stress. And then there's toxic stress. And that's that strong, frequent, prolonged stress. It could be the result of chronic neglect or even a caregiver of someone with a substance use disorder or mental illness may feel that toxic stress. Also, someone maybe who has some accumulated burdens of family economic hardships without enough support may also feel that toxic stress. So moving on to COVID-related stress. So COVID is causing all different kinds of stress for all of us. We have questions constantly, how can we find hand sanitizer or Lysol or Clorox wipes? I mean, the reality is those are some of the things that we're worried about, we're stressed about. Our routines might not be normal due to work or sleep schedules, and we may also have concerns about people wearing masks or not wearing masks. And we're also concerned about or worried about our livelihood and our job security. There's also secondary stress, and that's when others around us feel the stress that we feel, or someone else in your household or someone else who you're around may be feeling stress, and you're gonna feel that secondary stress. So there are many different types of different challenges that we all face, and we're all trying to cope So some of us cope better than others, and everyone acts differently in stressful situations. So there are many different common signs of distress. So they are kind of categorized by physical, behavioral, and emotional signs. So I'm going to go over a few, not limited to these, but this is just a one list. So someone might be feeling anxiety or having increased worry. They might not want to be separated from their loved ones. They might be irritable or be angry. Students might be upset because their parents are making them stay home, or they're taking away some of their activities or limiting activities. They may be feeling fatigued or exhausted. They might be feeling sadness, not knowing when all of this is going to end. They may be crying or having changes in their appetite. They might have a lot of changes in their sleep patterns. They might not be able to concentrate. They might be forgetful or have frequent errors or have difficulty making decisions. There might be a lot of confusion, or the person may have physical complaints like headaches or diarrhea. They might have nightmares, or they may have a new or increased use of tobacco products, alcohol, or drugs. So now we'll talk a little bit about anticipatory grief. So this is the feeling that we get about the future, about what the future holds when we're uncertain. So usually it centers around death. Maybe someone has a diagnosis, or someone in your family is sick, and you have that realization that someday someone in your family will pass away. So that's a normal thought, but this is something that you know that something is bad is there, but you can't see it. So I'll say that again, something bad is there, but you can't see it. And that's exactly what's happening with this virus. So with anticipatory grief, the mind goes directly to the future and imagines the worst. So in order to calm ourselves, we kind of come back to the present and we figure out, okay, well, what else can we do? So we have to kind of accept what's happening, kind of ground ourselves, come back to the present, and figure out what can we do to empower ourselves? What can we do to keep ourselves safe? So how can we support our children and our students during this time? So children may exhibit stress in a variety of different ways, and we understand that a lot of you may be listening are really interested in high school age students, but we did want to just give you an idea of how all ages react and how you can help. So you'll see too that some supports may even overlap for all of the ages. So that'll be, and actually even for adults as well. So I'm going to start out briefly to talk about infants. So infants might be crankier, they might cry more, want to be held. Younger children may revert to old behaviors like bedwetting or being frightened if they're separated from their parents. They may have more tantrums, they might have difficulty sleeping, or have a change in appetite. So in order to help the age infant to three, we can help by having them focus on their breathing. So we can do simple things like having them pretend to blow bubbles really slowly, or having them pretend to blow out birthday candles. So what we want to do is model this slow breathing so that they learn from us how to slowly breathe and how to cope. So from ages 3 to 6, you do want to be patient, and you want to provide reassurance and let them know that they're safe and that they have everything that they need, that you're providing that. You do want to try to avoid the news, and it's extremely important to maintain routines, having 3 meals a day, snacks, consistent bedtimes. You do want to encourage them always to express their feelings. So now we can look at ages 7 to 10. So older children might start to feel mad, sad, or afraid. They might not want to talk about what they're hearing, or they may want to talk a lot about it. So everyone's going to be different. They may have trouble concentrating. They might be crying, whining, have aggressive behavior. They may want to be around you more. They may be in need of a little more attention. They may have appetite changes or sleep changes as well, and they may have a loss in some of the activities that they used to do. So how can we help? So again, we want to be patient. You can see that's kind of a common thread so far. And we want to assure them that they're safe and let them express their feelings. Let them know that it's okay to feel upset and they can talk about it. You do also want to teach them coping mechanisms. Let them know that even adults use coping mechanisms when they're feeling stressed. So that's a great way to start to model all of that. You want to encourage virtual or socially distant time with friends, encourage exercise, encourage a routine with chores, making sure that these children feel that they're part of something and they're contributing to their family. You do, again, want to limit media time and encourage conversation with questions. So we always want to encourage that communication. So now we'll look at preteens and teenagers. So they may act out, they may feel overwhelmed with different emotions. They might not want to talk about it, they may want to, they may not. They may argue, they may be worried or have a lot of extreme sadness. They may be eating unhealthy, having unhealthy eating habits or sleeping habits. They may have trouble concentrating. They may resort to the use of alcohol, tobacco, or other drugs. They may also have a decrease in energy, and they may be isolating themselves. And I am gonna just focus a little bit about how the sleeping habits and the isolation can connect. So we do really wanna watch the sleep habits. We don't want students to do a day-night reversal to avoid family or avoid maybe being nagged to do chores or just to be around family members, because this really creates a disconnection with the family. This can lead to isolation, and we don't want that. Parents really need to work with their students and have reasonable expectations. They need to let their preteens and teens have some input and say, hey, you know, I want you all to hang out with the family during XYZ time during the day. You need to be responsible for doing certain chores. But then on the other side, I understand that you really want to stay up late and you really, when the rest of the family is sleeping, and you also want to sleep late too. And that's okay, but we have to have a middle ground. You have to be involved with the family. So we do want to just be careful with that and make sure that students aren't doing that day-night reversal. So how to help the preteens and teens? We do want to encourage communication with peers and with family, and even discussion about what's happening. And let them know that they're not alone. Let them know that you're there to help. And you can also help if they have anxiety or whatever they're feeling, you can help them manage that. You also want to encourage the connection with their friends as well as family, with virtual calls, being socially distant, games, movies, dinners, whatever your family likes to do together or whatever the student likes to do with their friends. Try your best to adapt to that. And encourage routine. Again, they shouldn't be sleeping all day. You do want to really encourage that routine. Okay, so now we'll talk about helping children cope with a disaster or a traumatic event. So we know that a traumatic event is an incident experienced or witnessed by a person that is perceived to be traumatic. So this event of COVID is affecting everyone differently. So for me, it could be extremely traumatic, but for others in my house, it might not be that traumatic. So it's really whatever feels traumatic to you would be considered a traumatic event. So we've talked about the signs and grief, and now I wanna really talk about accepting that we're here and this is our new normal, and how can we cope and how can we meet children where they are. So this may involve new routines, as I've talked about a few minutes ago, and we need to put these routines into place. So bedtimes, meals, activities, and this, again, goes for adults as well. You do want to share age-appropriate information and have discussions. Let children ask questions. have a dialogue, and be available to talk and listen. And we all need the reminder to put our phones away and really listen and have that conversation on whatever level the student, the child is wanting to talk. We do also want to limit media if possible. And then remember to be honest and to provide reassurance. We're not stuck at home, we're safe at home. So we do want to try to reframe that. And you know, we want to let all students know that we're doing everything that we can to be as safe as we can. So just to continue this topic, we also need to consider your role in the community and your family needs. So if you work outside of the home or you are an essential worker working outside of the home, your children may have more questions. If your child has, if you have a child with special needs, you can still be direct and do the things that are best for them. You do want to be honest and provide information such as the importance of hand washing and wearing a mask. So providing that information to them. You also do want to just remember to be present and keep the lines of communication open. You always want to be available when they're ready and meet them where they are. So now we're going to talk a little bit about protective factors. So we're going to focus a little more on the positive now. So protective factors refers to the supports, opportunities, and relationships our youth need across all aspects of their lives to achieve their full potential. So protective factors are the supports and the behaviors that act opposite to risk factors, like stressful events. So I'm just going to go over some protective factors. There are so many protective factors. This is just a very small list, but just to give you an idea. So we really need as many protective factors in our children's lives as possible. The more protective factors we have, the better. So we have high self-esteem, good problem-solving skills. And this is a great thing that we can model as adults. Especially during this time. Feeling in control of our own life. So you do want to make sure that your child is feeling like they are in control for, you know, reasonably, and make sure that they're involved and have some choices. So it's tough enough to be at home more so than we have in the past. So make sure that they're involved in their lives and they have choices. Maybe consistent routines, having though, again, like I had mentioned, family dinners, game nights, maybe exercising together. Whatever your family did when you had the time to do it, it's always good that to keep doing that and maybe even do more of that. Maybe regular school attendance and academic performance. So when I say this, I don't mean making sure students get all, you know, 100% straight A's. It means that they're consistent and they're showing that continued effort. So that they have that interest in school. And then feeling close to at least one adult. So this, I always say in all aspects of their lives, they need to feel close to at least one adult. Now I understand that this is going to look a little different this year, but there may still be a teacher. Your student may be in school, they may be online, but they can still make strong connections with a teacher or a neighbor or definitely a parent and even another family member. And even if that family member isn't even in the same state, they can still have virtual calls. They can still talk when they need to. But having those other adults for support is always a great protective factor. Another would be healthy practices. And I just can't say this enough. Making sure that children get enough sleep, they eat well, and they're exercising. We just want to make sure that they're connecting with their daily routine. So this is really the foundation, the strong foundation that we need, but it is a great protective factor. And then open communication. We always want that open communication to be there so that children can go to their parents or their trusted adult who they feel connected with and always talk about anything that's on their mind. And there are really three important times to increase protective factors when they get up, after school, or bedtime. Now, again, I understand that maybe after school will look a little different, and also it will look differently in the summertime because they're not in school. So it might be after an activity, or maybe it's when there's a little downtime in the afternoon, maybe it's extra time in the morning. So you do want to try to kind of hit those 3 points during the day and talk to your children, show them that you care, because that really does increase their self-esteem and it makes them feel supported. Therefore, those protective factors are just rising as you talk. So those are that's a great thing. So these protective factors, we just really want to reinforce that the more protective factors there are, the better.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about managing your stress. And with managing stress, it is important to be realistic with our expectations of ourselves and others. We need to set realistic daily goals, set limits for yourself and with others. It's important to have boundaries. You're not going to be able to be everything to everyone, and that's okay. It's not realistic for a parent with a child at home to maintain their usual level of productivity. So think about what can be reasonably accomplished in a day. Especially during COVID-19, decide what recommendations and ideas are practical for you in your situation. Maybe working from home in the morning is not ideal for your family's schedule, so you may be able to adjust your work schedule or shift the times a little. And just remember to be kind to yourself and that you're doing the best that you can. This is our reality right now, so try to cut yourself some slack. Other ways of managing your stress is to recognize changes in yourself. So think about how you're feeling and do you need emotional support right now? Extroverts and even some introverts may take the physical distancing harder, so try to find ways to connect with people. Self-care is definitely a necessity, and you can do that by maintaining healthy habits, eating a nutritious diet, exercising, creating time for yourself. Try to maintain a routine as much as you can. For example, setting your alarm clock and getting up at the same time every morning, eating meals around the same time, exercising around the same time, but also be flexible, and you may have to revise your schedule as needed. Add self-care to your routine. Give yourself, encourage family to take some self-care time. That could be maybe creating quiet time for an hour or two, or in my situation with my husband, if he can, he'll take the kids for a day so that I can have some time to myself, and then maybe the next day I'll take the kids so that he can go out and he can do things. Maybe he can have a day to play golf. So we try to switch on and off so that we can each have some quiet time and some downtime. Practice some stress management techniques like breathing, mindfulness activities, exercise, stretches, even journaling or coloring. And you can also practice those with family. Go for walks after dinner or do a family bike ride. You can also practice like guided imagery and imagine that you're somewhere peaceful like the beach or the mountains. Another way of managing stress is to problem solve. So again, for me on Sundays, that's usually the time that I make my grocery list and I plan the meals for the week. But if there's a day when I've been really busy or if I'm tired, then guess what? That's going to be a takeout night and we'll order pickup. So again, be flexible with your schedule. Or if you're used to taking your child to school or driving to work in the morning, maybe instead replacing that with a walk or drive to Starbucks every morning, which is something that I do. Treat yourself to something nice. And also practice kindness to yourself and others. Be patient as we're all trying to figure out this new way of life. Again, we can't reiterate enough. Be kind to yourself. You're doing the best that you can. With everything that is going on, we do need to remember to be mindful of others and then check in on people by calling or doing a Zoom meeting so that you can see each other. Be compassionate and patient if someone is struggling. Consider the person's age, gender, their cultural background. They may be struggling with some different issues. Pay attention to their communication, their verbal and nonverbal. Are they showing signs of stress or distress? And empathize with them. Also be aware of your own state, your own stress level. You can always suggest different resources, like different faith organizations. There are many local and county resources, which I'll be going over in a minute. There are also different hotline numbers, online things that people can do. Check in with your loved ones. Now with the age of technology, you can use video, you can FaceTime with people, text them. You can also resurrect letter writing. Everybody loves getting mail. You can do a morning coffee Zoom chat. You can just get really creative with things. Also, in order to help someone know what medications your loved one is taking so that you can help them, maybe you can do that by calling the pharmacy to refill a prescription or calling the doctor for them. When someone is struggling, it is up to us to notice. So here are some different programs that the county and our unit, specifically Wellness Health Promotion and Prevention, offers. We have mental health first aid, and that teaches participants about the signs and symptoms of different mental health disorders. And it also has the ALGE action plan on what to do in mental health crisis situations, which is assess for risk of suicide or harm, listen non-judgmentally, give reassurance and information, encourage appropriate professional help, and encourage self-help and other support strategies. So we've offered the youth version to the George Mason High School and the City of Falls Church community. We've worked closely with Gada and Rebecca, and we hope to be able to continue that partnership in the future. The county also offers the My Strength app that anyone can download, and it is free. It's a safe and secure and personalized set of tools to help support your mind, body, and spirit. It does have content for both youth and adults, and you're able to track your health. They have different activities. Some of the topics include sleep, anxiety, substance use, loss of a loved one. You can find ways to help deal with stress or chronic pain, and there's so much more that you can explore on the app. So we do encourage you to download that. You can click on sign up now and then enter the access code CSV community. And here's a brief video that we can show about what My Strength is.
We all struggle from time to time. My Strength is here to help you through it. It's a resource offered by your provider or sponsor at no cost, available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Whether it's depression, anxiety, stress, chronic pain, problems with sleep or substance use, or you just want to keep your emotional health strong, My Strength has a range of tools and resources that are customized just for you. Find inspiration, mood tracking, and hundreds of videos and activities that will empower you to feel better and stay better. Sign up today.
So we do encourage you to check out the My Strength app. This is another resource that the county offers. You can find a monthly calendar that has tons of ideas for self-care and activities for every day of the month. You can find it on the CSB webpage or on Facebook. If you like the CSB Facebook page, you can find it in your news feed. Katie is the person who created these monthly calendars with all of these fun ideas that you can do for yourself or for someone else. So for example, for today's activity for July 15th, it says that we can practice some mental challenges like a crossword puzzle or Sudoku. So again, these are some fun ideas that you can do for your mental health. If someone would like some spiritual support, they can call the number at the bottom of this slide and speak to a Fairfax County spiritual support team member. Help is available Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Through Fairfax County Department of Family Services, there is a parent support line available to help answer any parenting questions, and they do also have it in Spanish for those interested. Our unit offers the Revive Opioid Overdose and Naloxone training virtually, which is free. We can also set up customized trainings for groups, or you're more than welcome to sign up for an open enrollment class that we usually offer weekly. During the 60-minute virtual class, participants will learn how to recognize the signs and symptoms of an opioid overdose, how to administer the naloxone nasal spray to potentially reverse the effects of an opioid overdose, and what to do and not do when you're responding. So for Fairfax County, City of Falls Church residents, and Fairfax City, for those interested who attend the training, we can mail out the naloxone to you at no cost. And this is the link where you can sign up for an open enrollment class. And we also offer Spanish version. So feel free to contact me. Also, if you would like a customized training, I'd be more than happy to set one up for you. The CSB also offers assistance from a distance. So you would just call the CSB entry and referral number. I just want to note that the CSB has transitioned mainly to telehealth services via Zoom by phone or video because of the pandemic, but you can call Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And just know that help is available. In a life-threatening emergency, you always want to call 911. There is the number for emergency services, and they're available 24/7. There's also the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, and there's a separate extension for veterans, and there's a separate number for it in Spanish. There's also the Children's Regional Crisis Response, CR2, which is local. CR2 is a crisis stabilization program, and they serve up to the age of 17. However, they are working on an expansion up to the age of 21. And their goal is to prevent hospitalization and focus on stabilization and to provide resources to the youth who is struggling with mental health, and also provide resources for their family. They're usually pretty quick to responding to a phone call and getting to the youth physically. So there's always that resource. And there's also REACH, which is Crisis Stabilization for Individuals with Developmental Disabilities. The Fairfax County Prevention Coalition is also spearheading Tall Cop. That's a webinar on different drug trends. It was created by Officer Jermaine Galloway, who's regarded as one of America's top experts in drug and alcohol trends. There are 4 webinars with different topics that you can register for. One of them is actually occurring this afternoon on overall drug trends, and we'll be providing that resource to Gada and Rebecca. So all of these resources can be found on the Fairfax County CSB website, and we'll also be providing you with all of these resources again through Gada and Rebecca if you're interested. So lastly, we do want to leave you with this quote, because this is a difficult time for all, and everyone is trying to do the best that they can. We must find meaning not in the loss, but in our response. Meaning is what we do next. Through this pandemic, we have learned to leverage technology. We've reconnected with family and friends. We've continued to work, exercise, and attend school from home. We've improvised birthday parties and celebrations. We have architected new structures, routines. We have made new memories. We have reevaluated our priorities and commitments. We have expanded our contributions at work and in the community. We have reinvented how we deliver products and services. We've shown our resiliency, and we continue to do so even with all of this uncertainty. Our response to the pandemic and ultimately the future is about our determination and resourcefulness, initiative, grit, creativity, strength, kindness, gratefulness, intentionality, and courage. So we want to thank you all for everything that you've done and will continue to do. Give yourselves a pat on the back, because you deserve it. If you have any questions or concerns, feel free to contact us, and you can contact us by email, and we will get back to you. Again, we will be sharing all of these resources with Gada and Rebecca, so feel free to contact them for any questions that you may have. And also visit the CSB webpage as well. So again, thank you so much for joining us. And everyone, take care.